Belief can be a powerful force. No one knows that better than the people who are sure they've seen Bigfoot.
Sometimes I still can't believe that we saw what we saw.
About 7 feet tall, making a sound like a pig squealing or a woman screaming. And walking like a man, but looking more like a gorilla.
He looked like he had 6 fingers on each hand.
I come out here and rough talked him and run him off. And I said, get away from here. Get.
Good morning, Redemption. On this historic day, you are the first 10:45 Sunday morning crowd ever. It's a good thing that we had that 10:45 service because we were pretty well packed out at 9:15. But y'all, you're going to get the best sermon because I've already preached this once. So now I should know. I got a text message this morning from Daryl, and he said, preach like you know they almost didn't come. That's by Fred Craddock. The irony of that is I didn't know if I was going to be able to be here today. I've been fighting the allergy, and I've been in bed for 3 days, and didn't know if I had a voice, but here I am, and I'm going to preach like I almost didn't come. Yeah, I can do it. Okay, that's enough. Please be quiet. We start a new series today called Urban Legends, and it's actually more about spiritual myths that people believe. If you ever watched the show Finding Bigfoot, and I want you to be honest about this. Hold it. I want you to be honest, because I know that a lot of us like trashy TV. We just don't want to admit it, okay? How many have ever watched the show Finding Bigfoot? Okay, how many have ever wanted to watch the show Finding Bigfoot, but you were afraid somebody would find out? Well, I tried to watch it. I really did. I've tried to watch it 4 or 5 times. So, you know, they promise something new. So they bring you up to a point, you know, then they take a break and they come in, then they review everything that's happened before that. You've only got about 3 minutes of something new, and you finally get to the point where you realize they're never going to find Bigfoot. He's not going to be there. You may or may not have seen it. You may not be a big fan of it, but we've got a preacher, one of our preachers that is a big fan of the show, and he might even believe that there is such a thing as Bigfoot. Now, I'm not going to tell you his name, but his initials are Drew Thurman. And it's necessary. Now, you're going to see me do this from time to time. I made the statement that it's not if my voice goes, it's just when is it going to go, but it's going to go. It's necessary right now that I give you a technical definition of what an urban legend is. So an urban legend or an urban myth is a form of modern folklore consisting of unusual fictional stories often rooted in popular culture. The legends can be used for entertainment. They can be used for a semi-serious explanation for random events, such as disappearances or the appearance of a strange object. Every community's got an urban legend, you know that? There's a localized urban legend that goes along with, you know, alligators in the sewer and the man who washed his cat and wanted to quick dry it and put it in the microwave and exploded and all that kind of stuff. They're all out there. There's probably an urban legend associated with Martin County or Loogootee or Shoals or wherever. We had one in the little community that I lived in. It was Hook's Tomb. It was a mausoleum where both the husband and wife were buried in the mausoleum. I don't know what their name was. I think maybe the first name of the man was maybe Captain. I'm not sure. But it had a glass front. And you could look in and you could see the crypts where they were buried. And the legend was that if you went and knocked on the door, it would knock back and walk around it and you could smell roses. So that became very famous in our area. And we investigated it more than once, but it was common for people from other towns to come, especially manly boy types, to bring their girlfriends and want to take them to Hook's tomb. So at the local hangout, which was one of the service stations on the corner, they would often stop there and we would direct them to Hook's tomb, but we would take them the long way around. And we took the shortcut and we got there before they did, and we would be on top of the mausoleum behind the tombstones. And so when they crept up to it and knocked on the door and walked around, that's when we jumped down from the mausoleum, and that's whenever we would pop up from behind the tombstones, and those manly boys would run off like screaming little schoolgirls, leaving their dates behind. Well, needless to say, we debunked the urban legend of Hook's tomb. But here's something that we got to tell you. We also have urban legends in the church. In other words, things that we say or things that we believe that are rooted in our culture, what some people believe. Maybe you've heard some of them, such as God helps those who help themselves. Have you ever heard that before? It's often repeated. Have you ever heard this? Cleanliness is next to godliness. Problem with that is none of those are in Scripture. They're made up by other people. And sometimes Scripture is used to maybe be a springboard for people to get into that. And sometimes these urban legends that we say to one another are more of wishful thinking than they are reality. Well, today we're going to take a look at one that is probably the most well-intentioned when it's spoken to one another, but it's a spiritual myth. And in reality, it can turn out to be very, very harmful if we're not careful. But I want to tell you that it's an offer of an explanation for something that turns out to be inexplainable. I've had it said to me many, many times by people who mean well. I've heard it said many, many times. I know people have the intention, and there are moments whenever that it hurts to actually hear it. But what I have to do in the moment is to look into the heart of the person that's saying it. So it is well-intentioned, and it goes like this. Everything happens for a reason. I mean, that's a myth. And I'm going to tell you why we believe that. closely related to that, that's often said in the same breath. Everything happens for a reason. And God must really be up to something in your life. This is all a part of His plan. Now, you might wonder where this comes from. It comes from Shakespearean English of Romans 8, 28 and 29. It's a text that's often quoted, but if you're like me, I learned that from the King James Version. And there are not many people that are Shakespearean English speakers now. So it was a bit confusing, but this comes out of it. And in the King James, it says, "For we know that everything works together for the good to those who love God, who are the called according to His purpose." That everything works together for the good. The problem with that is in our language now, words have different meanings and syntax is differently. It's translated now in the New International Version in chapter 20, verse 8, 28 and 29 like this. "And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. For those God foreknew, He predestined to be conformed into the likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers." You see, this myth of everything happens for a reason is particularly dangerous whenever we're irresponsible with it. And I'm going to give you four reasons why, just to start off, why this myth is dangerous. First of all, when we say this to people, it can cause people to be angry with God for no good reason. In other words, whenever we say this, everything happens for a reason, God must be up to something in your life, it's all a part of His plan, they see God as the cause for everything. meaning the diagnosis of leukemia for the little boy that's 5 years old, the untimely death of a child, or the disease that comes out of nowhere, or the tragic accident, or the killer that goes on a killing spree, or an idiot with a nuclear bomb in North Korea. You know, people see God as responsible for everything. And then sometimes they say, well, if it's a part of God's plan, then good will ultimately come about regardless of what it is. It can cause people to be angry with God. Let me tell you something. Unless you've got a knowledge of grace and the justice and the justification of God, you're not going to get that. That statement of how God can work in it, you're not going to get it. And as a matter of fact, this promise in Romans 8:28, that we know that God in everything works for the good to those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. It's only for two types of people. This promise is made for those who love God. And how do we know we love God? It says, if you love me, you obey me. And it's for those who have been called according to his purpose. It's for those who have stepped out to accept him. That I can make a statement with assurance today that in everything, God is working for good. It doesn't say everything that happens is good. So the person down the hallway from me that may be at working, who just has a diagnosis of autism for a child, who has no faith in Christ, who doesn't understand anything about grace, who doesn't understand anything about purpose, that promise is not for them. And for me to look at him and say, well, you know, God is in this, it can cause anger. I have been with parents, teenagers, 17 years old, dies in a car wreck unexpectedly, and the only thing that someone can say, why? It would be cruel, absolutely cruel, to go to that person and say, well, you know, there's a reason for everything. God has something big for you, as if God is the cause of it. You see how angry that can make someone be. I've actually had someone, now I'm going to be blunt here, and I want you to get it, and I want you to understand what I'm about to say. I've actually had people that in those moments have said, they say everything happens for a reason, but I want to know what the hell the reason is. You might look at that and say, boy, what if, no, you look in their face and you see confusion and you see anger and you see doubt and you see a total loss of how to respond. You see, that can be dangerous. It can also be dangerous in that it can allow people not to take responsibility for their own choices. Well, you know, everything happens for a reason. You know, God is up to something. We can live recklessly and make foolish choices, and the catastrophe comes our way, and then we look at it and say, well, you know, everything happens for a reason. You can make choices. You can make business ventures. You can do all kinds of things. You can refuse wise counsel. You can do things that you know you shouldn't do that make absolutely no sense, and it collapses. And then you look at it and say, well, you know, I've been told that everything happens for a reason. Yes, it does. And I have to bear responsibility for it. It can also cause people to gloss over sin. Well, it's all a part of God's plan. You know, I've had that said to me. You know, well, you know, it's the way God designed it. You know, it was an unplanned, you know, unplanned pregnancy. We didn't want that for her, but you know, everything happens for a reason. I think we can figure out what that reason was. See, that's not complicated. But we can do sinful things, and we can pay the price for it, and then we can just simply say, now I'm not saying that that's worse than anything else. I'm just telling you what's been said to me before. Well, everything happens for a reason. Well, the reason was I disobeyed God, and then everything collapsed. It can also cause people to misplace hope. In other words, there's an earthly fix for everything. We believe that good in this life will overcome all the doom and disappointment if we just hold on long enough that everything happens for a reason. Something good is going to come out of this. And I want to tell you sometimes that there's disaster that you and I don't ever, ever see change. Now, there's two ways to approach, excuse me, the reason why things happen in God's universe. I'm going to have to do this a lot, folks. Number one, there's a view that's closely related to the term called Calvinism. And it's based on the teaching of John Calvin, one of the reformers in the Reformation movement. But actually, he got his teaching from the early church father, Augustine, and Augustinianism. Now, here's the good thing about Calvinism. It emphasizes the supreme authority of God, that God is sovereign. And this is good, that he's over all. But this also means that God predetermines and preorchestrates everything that has or will happen. This may seem a little boring now, but I'm going to get through it. Well, I don't believe that God micromanages everything. And I believe that the extreme to that can paint that picture, that God is in every little detail, that he causes, orchestrates everything, if you take that to the extreme. I don't believe that God micromanages sporting events. I don't believe that God makes the last shot go in. I'm sorry, I don't, because I've been on the losing end too many times where the last shot didn't go my way, and I want to say God had nothing to do with that. You just got lucky. Sometimes I'd rather be lucky than good. But the other side of that is what we call Arminianism. Now, Arminianism means that you reject Calvinism, and the emphasis of Arminianism is the free will of man. So is there any way that we can blend the idea that God is supreme authority and in charge of everything, but yet allows free will? I believe that God allows free will, because I see that only a sovereign God in total control can allow me to have any decision that I make. And so therefore, I like that. But here's the danger with Arminianism. If we take that to the extreme, it means that God has nothing to do with anything. It's all our choice. He set it in motion, and it is what it is. I reject that too. Scripture teaches that God is in control. Scripture teaches that he has complete authority, that he is in the universe. But I do not believe, listen very closely, that Scripture teaches that God is the direct cause of everything. But understand something. And this is really important that you get it. The Scripture does affirm the reality of cause and effect. When it comes to our lives, we have a plan, not necessarily a blueprint. Now, what do I mean by cause and effect? Well, the book of Galatians, chapter 6, verses 7 and 8 says this: a man reaps what he sows. If he sows to his sinful nature, that means who I am without the work of God in my life, then I will from that nature reap destruction. My life is going to fall apart. But if I sow to the Spirit, capital S, which is the Spirit of God, I will from the Spirit reap life. So it's my choice. What am I going to go after? Am I going to go after this or this? Whatever I choose bears a consequence. Just like whatever you plant in your garden, that's what's going to grow. Whatever you put there, it's going to produce fruit, and you're not going to be able to deny it. Well, if God doesn't orchestrate everything, and if it's not true that everything happens for a reason, why do we explain then things that happen? Is there an offering for it? Well, let me tell you why things go wrong, and sometimes things are disastrous. It could be, I'm going to give you four. Four reasons why things happen. Number one, excuse me, I could be the reason why things are happening the way they are. It could be because of my choice and I'm reaping what I've sown. For instance, let's say I choose to text and drive. That's one bad decision that leads to an accident, which could be destructive. That's a cause and effect. I don't think God had anything to do with that, except in that he allowed it to happen. But it's my choice. You see, I can go to college and party too much and flunk out. I can get drunk and be hungover rather than go to class. God didn't do it, you did. A marriage falls apart. We quit caring about each other. We behave in selfish ways. We forget to take into consideration the role that we play in our marriage. Everything begins to fall apart, and I may need to look in the mirror and say, what's the reason for this? And I may be looking right straight at the reason there. God doesn't have anything to do with that, but I do. You see, we can physically neglect ourselves. We can eat as we shouldn't eat. Now, I'm not, you want to go home and have a ding-dong, have one. I don't care. You know, if you want to go get a Big Mac, a super Big Mac, you can do that. I'm just telling you, I'm a stroke survivor. I've had a stroke. You see, that we can neglect our bodies. We can go without rest. We can eat what we shouldn't eat. We can form all kinds of bad habits. We can refuse the sleep that our body says that we need, and we can have a stroke when we're 40. I didn't have one when I was 40. I had one when I was 64, you know. But you see, the point that I'm making is that we can do all kinds of things that are going to cause something to happen, and I could be the reason for it. Sometimes you and I have self-inflicted wounds, and they are sins that we committed, and that causes things to happen that are not going to go away for us. Now, we can be forgiven of it. God will no longer hold it against us, but that doesn't mean that there isn't a set of consequences in motion that even though we're forgiven and things are different, we still have to endure the consequence. You know, we can abuse our body with drugs. And we see this. We see so many times whenever an infant in the womb has been affected by cocaine or methamphetamine, which causes a permanent defect. And people can be clean from that and wish it never happened and get forgiveness, but it doesn't change the fact that this is a consequence of something that's happened. When we start looking at why things happen, look in the mirror, I might be the cause for it. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 3 says, A man's own folly ruins his life, yet his heart rages against the Lord. Sometimes I'm the reason, and there's no room for me to rage against anyone but myself. I'm going to make it. I only got about 55 more minutes to preach. That's supposed to be funny. Secondly, others could be the reason. Let's say I'm the one that gets hit by the driver that's texting. What did I do? Nothing. I was just driving. This person's decision affects me. Companies go out of business because management makes bad decisions, maybe even dishonest decisions. And I've worked or you've worked for years and built up what we thought was going to be a successful career, only to be without a job because of what someone else has done. You get it. You had nothing to do with it, but yet you're going to suffer from it. Thirdly, let me tell you that Satan could be the reason why things happen in the world. Satan is real, but we don't want to over-acknowledge what it is that he does. But he does have a work that he wants to perform. And that means that he wants to wreak havoc on the population of the world because he hates people. He hates the church. He hates anything that goes on in the world. And he's out there doing business. But we got to be careful that we don't blame the devil for the things that we do. You know, some of you will not have any idea who this is, but many, many years ago, a black comedian by the name of Flip Wilson would say, "The devil made me do it." No, the devil may have put it in front of you to do, but you made the decision to do it. But listen, the devil is real. Jesus affirms that. He says in John chapter 10, verse 10, that the thief, which is the devil, comes to steal, kill, and destroy. That's his mission in life. If it's good, he wants to steal it. He wants to kill it. He wants to destroy it. He hates anything good. And Jesus teaches that he's on the attack. God has nothing to do with anything that's evil. Nothing at all. I didn't say this in the first sermon, but I remembered I was going to. Years ago, I was working with a young man when I was doing youth ministry that was making great strides in his life, but he got back into the wrong crowd. He fell off, and he was doing some things. And a youth sponsor said to me, he said, "Well, God's just testing Jimmy to see how strong he is." I said, "You mean he's testing him with the stuff that he saved him from?" God has nothing to do with evil. And if right now something is going on in your life that you don't understand, and it's wreaking havoc in your life, and you're wondering what the source is, you wonder where it's coming from, don't ever agree with anything that Jesus wouldn't say to you or do in your life. Because if he wouldn't say it and he wouldn't do it, it's not coming from him. I don't care what you say. Anything that takes you away from his word and obedience to him is not God-led. It's from his enemy. You can count on it. That's a fact. Paul teaches us in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. The devil is up to something. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 17, I'm just going to paraphrase it. It says that the devil, who is a real being who fell from heaven, once an angel, a fallen angel, dedicated to destroy anything that is good, now that he knows that he can't destroy Jesus, he can't destroy the church. Revelation 12, 17 says that he is now on a campaign to make war against all who obey God's command. He can't destroy the church as a whole, but he's coming after you and me to steal from us, to kill from us, to destroy what is good. Listen, spiritual warfare is real. It's going on right now. There's a battle between all that's right and all that's wrong, but we know who's going to win. But keep in mind that there are things that go on in the world that we are affected by it, that Satan is the source. In other words, there's active evil in the world. Children get kidnapped. They're two girls are hiking and they're murdered. That's evil. Jeffrey Dahmer, I just watched a special about him. They ruled that he was absolutely sane when he committed all of those murders. But by his own words, he said, I plunged deeper and deeper into evil. Did you know that he accepted Christ and was baptized before he died? He was led to Christ in a Bible study. And Jeffrey Dahmer found forgiveness in the only place where he could find it, and that is with Jesus Christ. He didn't treat him the way he deserved to treat him. He gave him grace. He died in prison. He was murdered. But there's evil in the world, and Satan is behind it. He's not going to make it easy for you. You need to understand it, and he will use whatever he can in your life to discourage you and to combat you and destroy you. And sometimes the things that happen are just simply because there's evil in the world, and people who are not evil are victimized by it. He hates anything that's good. He hates Jesus, and he hates anybody that's following him. And that leads us to number four. You see, things happen in the world because of fallenness. Fallenness could be the reason. Now, let me explain to you what I mean. In Genesis chapter 3, we have the record, the recording of Adam and Eve sinning against God. And when they sinned, everything changed in God's creation. And it means that the world that is not the world. The world that is now is not the world that was. So when Adam and Eve sinned, here's what happened. Their relationship with God changed. They were in direct communication with God, talking with God, being with him in the garden. He was drawing them into this wonderful relationship in the Garden of Eden. But they disobeyed him, and Satan was active, tempting them. And they chose to go against what God desired for what they wanted. And that's the heart of sin, me going after what I want other than what God wants. So that led to disobedience, and everything changed. When they once sought out the presence of God, when God was with them, came to them, they went to him. But after sin, they ran away from God. They were ashamed to be in his presence. That's the way it works, doesn't it? You know, we know better, but we do it anyway. So this is what happens. Their relationship with God changed. Then if you read the account closely, their relationship with each other changed. There became tension between Adam and Eve. So what was supposed to be, you know, revealing the glory of God now became a source of possibility of dissension and separation. And then their relationship with the planet changed. That what they were supposed to master and take care of now became dangerous and dysfunctional. See, that's why we have storms. That's why we have all of these things that go on that take human life, that destroy things that are good. It was a cataclysmic moment. And as a result, Romans chapter 8, verses 20 through 22 says that the world is now under a curse. The entire world is. This is a dysfunctional, dangerous place. We are living in a fallen world. The world that is not the world that was. And all of us are going to be affected by it in some way or another. I've had people ask me before, why did this happen? Why did this tornado come through and destroy all of this? Why is there this disease? Why do children suffer in poverty? Well, you know, there's a reason for everything. You know, God is up to something big. I have stood with people as they looked down at their 9-year-old son, as they held the infant in their arms that was no longer had the breath of life in it. I've heard them ask why, and they look at me and say, why has this happened? And I say, I don't have all the answers, but I can tell you this. We live in a fallen world, and unfortunately, you've just faced the reality of its heartbreak. You see, there are examples where God is at work, even causing some things to happen. I believe that there are times that I've been put where I have been put for a divine appointment, that I was right where I needed to be at the right moment, to say what needed to be said in the moment, but that's different than saying that God micromanages absolutely everything in my life, that he gives me no choice as to how things are going to go. I can tell you, I believe that God is at work, but we are living in a fallen world, and there is no way that you and I are ever going to escape it. You see, God knows what's ahead, and he's already there. You see, when he's directing my life, he knows what's ahead, and through other things, he can use it to produce what it is he wants to produce in my life. We're going to get back to that in just a moment. For instance, God didn't cause the Jews to kill Jesus, but he knew it was coming, and he wrote it into his plan so that you and I might be redeemed. God can use everything for his purpose. That's what Romans 8:28 says. That in all things, God is working for the good. No matter what happens to me, God is doing something. But that doesn't mean that he's the direct cause of it. What's the answer to the good that God is doing? Well, it's in verse 29. Let me read it to you again. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. You know what the good is that God's doing? Listen to me. You know what the predetermined result of me coming to Christ to be right with God is? That God would not only forgive me, but he would make me like his son. He would transform me more into the character and like the person that Jesus is. That is what God is in doing. That's what God is doing in every circumstance. So I may not fully understand it. I may not understand a reason, but I know in the circumstance, he's going to make me what he wants to make me. That's what I choose to focus on in my life. And here's why. Daryl said this, and I'm going to say it too. Daryl and I are preaching the same sermon today, but it's his, and I'm making mine mine. Reason can be overrated. He asked me not long ago, he says, if you knew the reason why Leah died and others don't, if you knew the reason why her breast cancer was incurable, that's our oldest daughter, our grandson's mother, if you knew that, if you could pinpoint exactly and say, this is why it happened, would that help you? I said, absolutely not. Absolutely not. It will not lessen the pain. It doesn't make me miss her any less. It doesn't lessen, you know, my desire to speak with her again. If I knew everything about it, that doesn't change anything. Why is it that you want to know? I've come to this conclusion, people, that I cannot micromanage my life. There are some things that happen in this world because this is a dangerous place, and I'm going to be touched by it. I have come to the conclusion, and you guys are, you're getting something that the other people didn't get. I am not God. I'm not him. I cannot make everything turn out the way that I want it to turn out. Again, getting ready for this message and accepting the fact of what Solomon says in the book of Ecclesiastes, there are some things you can do nothing about. You can't change it. You're not in control. I went out to the cemetery. I told Ruth, I'm going to the cemetery. And because I wanted to get this, I wanted to get hit with this reality again going into this message. And I'm not a cemetery person, but it's become a sacred place for me. A grave is just the receptacle of the body. That's not the final place. But I went to the cemetery. I stood facing the west, looking at her name. And as the sun went down, I came to the conclusion again, I can't do anything about this. I'm not in control. So how do I respond to it? I want to tell you something, folks. There's always a path. There's always a path that we can choose in the midst of everything that goes wrong. And there's a couple of them. Number one, we can get angry and we can refuse to see it as it is and our pride takes over. But when it comes to my relationship with God, wanting to be in a closer relationship, understanding who God is, if it's all about my pride, if it's something that I can't accept, you see, reason can become a God. It can be something that I pursue. But isn't it comforting to know that we have a God that is so big and so powerful and so awesome that our feeble little mind can't comprehend who he is? Isn't that great? That's how big he is. But if you and I have pride, that's a trap door, and it's going to open, and we're going to fall before we ever get to the presence of God. But the other path is always this. Whenever we are in the midst of circumstances that seek to draw everything that it can from us, when life goes wrong, when inequity is everywhere, and if you're looking for fairness in this life, you're not going to find it. This world is not fair. Wicked people prosper. People who serve God live in poverty. Wicked people control money. People who love God and serve God sometimes are abused by those that have it. If you're looking for fairness, you're not going to get it. Even God's people can treat us unfairly. People have told me, they said, it's not fair what's happened to you. I said, well, it may not be. And they've said, you don't deserve this. And to which I look at them and say, yes, you're exactly right. I deserve far worse. I deserve far worse. And there's all kinds of things that could happen to me. But you see, I'm not going to leave this world untouched. The other path is obedience and faith. That's the other path. No matter what the circumstance is, no matter how poor it is, if I don't have a reason for it that I am aware of, it doesn't matter because I'm always presented with the opportunity, will I obey God or will I not obey God? And that's what matters. Not the reason for why it's happened, unless it's me, I'm sinful, I'm the cause of it. But I'm going to tell you, you're going to be standing before things sometimes that there's no answer for it. But it's heartbreaking, and it's cruel. That's why our bodies wear out. That's why things don't go perfectly for us. But there is coming a day where everything will be all right. Everything will be as God intended it to be. It's just not here on this planet. So what are we going to do? Curse the darkness and live in pride? Are we going to obey God? Allow him to be God in all of the circumstances. C.S. Lewis says, life with God is not immunity from difficulties, but peace in the midst of difficulties. Life with God is not immunity from difficulties, but peace in the midst of it. I've actually had people come to me and say, do you believe that when you become a Christian, accept Jesus, then everything's going to be fine? I said, no, it could get worse than it's ever been for you. You could have more heartache and could have more trouble than you ever thought you were going to. But in the midst of all the difficulties, we can have peace. And Jesus is the source of our peace. Rick Ashley, great preacher, says the empty tomb trumps a whole head full of reasons. Let me say that again. We're just coming off Resurrection Sunday, where we've celebrated the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Rick Ashley says the empty tomb trumps a whole head full of reasons. As long as the tomb is empty, we have reason to press on. When we can't see what God is doing, we hold on to what He has done and what He promises to do. If I'm in the midst of a circumstance where I feel like my feet are not touching the floor, I can hold on to the reality that the tomb is empty, that Jesus stood against the two greatest enemies of humanity, sin and death, and He knocked them out of the park. They're not even an issue for us anymore. As long as the tomb is empty, it trumps a whole head full of reasons. I don't need to know because I know what He's already done. And I know nothing is going to change that. I want to read Romans chapter 8. Now, some of it's going to be up on the screen, but I want to read more verses maybe than you're going to see. Listen to me. I want you to hear this. What then shall we say in response to all this? Everything that can go wrong. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us, how will He not also, along with Him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those to whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is He that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword, as it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep for the slaughter. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. No matter what happens, I don't need to know a reason. All I need to know that God will use whatever happens for my good, that I might become more like Jesus and be part of His family. You see that? So everything happens for a reason? Well, yeah, I guess it does. There's always a cause and effect. But God's not the cause for everything that happens. Not the cause. But He is the solution for my sin and the inequity and that which is disastrous in our world. Today I ask you, do you know Him as your Lord and Savior? Have you made Him? Have you asked Him to be your Lord and Savior? Are things right with God and you because of Him? Will you pray with me, please? God, thank You for the day. Thank You for Your love. Thank You for Your goodness. We give You praise. In Jesus' name.